Greetings from EPG Pathshala. Today we are going to talk about web threats. Web consists of two things, client and server. Client is the one who sends the request, server is the one who fulfills the request and passes the information. What kind of threats can occur at the client level? What kind of threats can occur at the server level? Why attackers target server attacks, and how on what countermeasures we can take against these threats that we are going to discuss in detail. To start with client level threats. Client level threats, there are two types of client level threats. One is a cross site scripting and another is unpatched web clients. To start my discussion with client cross-site scripting, the first threat at the client level, what does an attacker do? Attacker actually wants to inject an HTML data into web content. You all know when a web request is generated, it is actually an HTML code. Now, what an attacker wants to do? It wants to trick the user into visiting the cross-site script vulnerable website. Still, the keyword is unknown to you. What is cross site scripting? I will tell you in a minute, but the focus is the attacker would try to attract a user to go to a site which is XSS vulnerable. Here, the attacker has injected some HTML code, and that would get executed on the user's browser. So, what happens? For example, user thought that it would just display a message, but because of cross-site scripting attack, it runs the code and does a malicious activity. Now, just to give you an idea, open a notepad and try to type this and save it as a JSP file. Even though you are not familiar what is a JSP, it's a very simple thing. You can type it out, HTML, body, hello, and within this you have to write, this is a scripting tags, so which actually gets executed, out.println, it is nothing but you are asking to print a message that is welcome, request.getParameter. Request is an object which gets a parameter name. Now, we just simply want to print a message Ahmedabad body and HTML tag complete. So, tag started, tag ended, tag started, tag ended. What is our focal point? Out.println, welcome. So, you are asking a request object to get a parameter that is name. Now, how would you run it? You have to run it HTTP localhost 8080. Now, on my machine, I have installed the Apache server. You may have any server, Apache, IIS. So, accordingly, you have to give your server name. Where you have stored the test.jsp file, I have stored it in the CSS folder under the server directory. So, test.jsp. Now, if you remember my code, it says you have to pass a parameter saying name. So, in my URL I am typing name is equal to LDCE. So, what do you want our object to do? It just wants to print a message welcome and whatever name you have passed. So, it would say hello, welcome LDCE and Ahmedabad. So, this is nothing smart happened here. We just passed a name and it got printed. But instead of writing name is equal to LDCE, how we have changed, we are typing name is equal to script alert hello and script ends. So, instead of passing simple text, we are now passing the script tag and we are writing some functionality in between the script tag. So, what can you observe if you try to do this? It would print hello, welcome, and a alert box would be popped up with a message hello. In this case, you did not find out any malicious activity, but an attacker can write anything between this script tag that will get executed on your browser. This is just a simple example of an alert message. Idea is clear that instead of just a simple plain text, the attacker passed the script tag and it got executed on the browser. So, these are the observations in the second case. The observations, as I mentioned earlier, there are two cases, name is equal to LDC, name is equal to script tag. In the second code, in the second case, the script code gets executed. What are the countermeasures against this? Educate the developers. Usually what happens, the coding, the one who develops the website, they have just given a test that input should be a alphabetic or numeric, but they do not validate. If they would have validated the input saying that no script tags are allowed in the input, then the script attack would not have occurred. So, the idea is educate the developers. They should sanitize and validate all inputs that could potentially be used as a part of dynamic generated web responses. Dynamic generated web responses is a kind of script tag which takes some action on the browser. Statically means it just prints a text. The next is what you can do is encode the URL. How? So, URL encoding is performed to convert data passed via HTML forms. As in the input, it may contain slash, dot, hash and other special characters. These characters have a special meaning. They are not a valid character for an URL or could be altered during transferred. If you want to understand what is a special hash, has a special meaning, so it needs to be encoded. The space character also need to be encoded because it is not a part of valid URL. So, when you are passing a URL and if it contains space, it would be termed as an invalid URL, but still you want space to be part of the URL, you have to encode is. If you are confused with what am I trying to say by encode, it say simply says just substitute another character for the space. Some characters such as tilde might not transport properly across the internet. So, encode URL, URL encoding is visible when we are dealing with forms. Those who have done the web programming, they are familiar with get and post method. What purpose get and post methods are? They are for passing the parameters from one form to another form, or to in other terms to pass parameters between HTML pages. So, here is an example. Suppose form method equal to get, action is equal to example dot html. It says that from this form you go to example dot html form and take the necessary parameters to this HTML page by get method. So, what is the difference between get and post? Get says when you pass a parameter, they are part of the URL, and post says when you want to pass the parameter, they will pass as a body of HTTP protocol. HTTP is hypertext transfer protocol, which is used to transfer data on the internet. Input type is equal to text, name is equal to var, size equal to 50, value is equal to, this is a simple and short test. If you correlate my discussion with the previous slide, this value has a space which is not a part of valid URL. As you know, it is a get method, so this has to pass as a part of URL. So, we have to convert this space to some other character, and AND has a special meaning. So, it has to be converted. So, submit query, if you click on the submit query, a query would be generated. It looks like this: www tutorial URL encoding example.html. Now variable is equal to this plus is plus a plus simple plus percentage 26 plus short plus test. So observation is space is converted to plus and is converted to percentage 26. This was about URL encoding, where the special characters are encoded into some other characters. Now the term is HTML encoding. So this is a simple HTML code, HTML body hello, body tag ends here and HTML tag ends here. Now what does, if you go for encoded HTML, you all know the less than sign would be substituted by ampersand LT and greater than sign would be substituted by. So one who reads the code, the readability would be less, ampersand LT semicolon HTML percentage GT semicolon. So now it is clear, for less than sign we have this and for greater than sign we have this. This is called HTML encoding. Now when the text is encoded, HTML code is not protected, would make the code difficult to understand. That means you have seen, when you are in a browser, you have a facility called view the source. If you view the source, you can read out the HTML. So if that HTML is not encoded, one can easily read it, but if there is an encoding of the HTML is done, the readability would be less. It would be difficult for one to understand what the HTML code is. Since you are dealing with HTML, there are two properties that are attached to HTML. One is inner text property and other is inner HTML property. Inner text property assures that your content remains safe and unexecutable. Inner HTML is used to programmatically modify the contents within the opening and closing tags. So you know what do I mean by opening and closing tags. And inner text property automatically encodes special characters to and from entities. Fine. So we are focusing on two properties, inner HTML and inner text. Now for example, if you have this bold tag, this says bold tag, this is end of the bold tag, and in between you have my text. So how the bold tag starts? With the less than and greater than sign, right? So it's a starting and closing tag. If inner HTML is used, then this starting and closing tag will not be recognized. But if inner text will be used, it would be encoded as ampersand LT, and this would be encoded as ampersand GT. Now since the encoding is done, decoding also has to be performed on the receiver side, and that would be performed by the browser. So just to once again put a point, you have two properties, inner HTML and inner text. If it would have been inner HTML, then this opening and starting and closing tag would not have been recognized. Now if it is inner text property, they would have been converted into the special encoding of the HTML. Now if there are any measures, client level countermeasures against XSS, the first we have seen is just to validate and sanitize the input. The second is educate users, educate for the threat of XSS, view web content only from the sources whom you trust, implement the browser security. So in your browser there are options that disable the JavaScript or active scripting for untrusted zones. So try to disable them. Now the second is unpatched web browser attacks. To get you sync with my discussion, we started with client level threats. The first one was cross-site scripting. The second is unpatched web browser attacks. Now attackers can sit in the middle when the data is being transmitted over the internet or over any network. They just take the data from the middle. Attackers lure the users to URLs where they can exploit weaknesses in things like ActiveX control. Now patching would be done to get a more security. If you are synced with the latest developments, there was a ransomware attack and the remedy was there was a patch available from a particular site and you have to download it on your machine. So patch is nothing, but there are certain modules, those have been added to counter against the attack. Now when we are talking about patch, how would you recognize that which patch is to be added to your machine? So there are two ways, either automatically or manually. Automatically means your machine would try to check that what patch is available, what patch version is available and what you have on your machine. If they differ, it will automatically download. Manually means go to a particular website, find out what kind of patch is available right now and match it with what you have on your machine. If they differ, try to download it down manually and implement. So this was all about client level threats. Now we are going to talk about server level threats. So web servers are much easier than other servers. To have an analogy, there can be database server, but database server always contains the company's data, so it is protected, highly protected. But web server, which is open for the public, anyone can get the data from the web server. So web server, there are many chances that they get attacked. There are many web servers than database servers. Web servers are often easier to attack because many websites do not take authentication, or while you are accessing the web server, it doesn't ask for the authentication. Sometimes attacker wants notoriety, saying that he or she wants to be famous by attacking a web server. Now for a company, if company's web server is being attacked, they can have a financial loss or they can lose their reputation. Who attacks company's web server? Usually ex-employees who are not happy with a company, they would try to attack the company's web server. What are the common web server threats? Repudiation, information disclosure, elevation of privileges and denial of service. To start with repudiation, if a web server gets compromised or attacked by a denial of service, it is necessary to determine how the attacker intruded. Now to give you an example of denial of service, what an attacker does, attacker sends ping messages to a machine. Attacker sends so many ping messages that the server cannot reply, and ultimately server says, I am tired, I cannot not take any more request, and it would halt. So attacker is trying, or intruder is trying, to send as many messages as it can. So what is the solution to find out that attacker has done this? Log all activities. So repudiation is to find out who all tried to perform certain actions on a particular server. How to do logging and how to check whether the logging is enabled. So for that, what you have to do is on your machine, this is a case study of IIS server. So What you have to do is you have to go to run. You all know in the start you have run, you have to type inet mgr and check the web server property. Now if you have IIS server installed on your machine, and if you type inet mgr, it would open up this screen. In that, what you have to do is you have to go to a tab called default website. If you open the properties, it would tell you all the properties that it can open. Now in that property, which property you are interested in is the website property. So click that tab. In that you have an option called enable logging. So you have to, if it is not tick marked, you have to tick mark so that all the activities that occur on your machine is being logged. So this is how we checked whether the logging is enabled or not. Now once again, to check whether the log has been generated or not, through a browser request a resource. The resource has not to be valid and should be unique. So just type http test site test home, I am testing to see logging is enabled .html. Now it does not exist, this HTML, this page does not exist. So what it has to do, it has to say somebody tried to open this website. So check for the log file, search for the files with .log extensions. You know how to perform search in the Windows operating system. So try to find out try to search for the .log files. Now open the web server's log file and make sure the request for home I am testing to see logging is enabled .html was recorded. So if you see this, you can see there are log files have been generated. These are the log files. Open the log files which has been recently opened, and you can see there is some the time from where it has been generated, what was the request, and the whole request has been enabled, and 404 says the web page was not found, right? So this is how an activity has been logged. The second is information disclosure. There are two types of information disclosure. One is server header disclosure and the second is directory browsing. First we would check server header exposure. For that you have to type a command telnet www.ldc.edu/80. This 80 is an HTTP port. So where would you type this? You would type it in the run. All things we would do, when you go to start, there is an option called run. When you open this, you type this, and then you type head/http 1.0. So it would show you content type, date, connection, and content length. So connection is close, content type is HTML. What was the date and what was the content length? So it asks for the server header, and it will show you the content. From the content, from the response, you can analyze that this is a close, connection is closed, so you cannot access it. If the connection would have been opened, you could have done further investigations. When we go for directory browsing, what is the idea? That if you are trying to go to a page, now that page is not there in the particular website. So what a developer does, it usually shows you the default page saying default.htm. But in case the developer forgot to put that default page, what happens? The visitor would show you, a visitor would be shown the particular files in a directory, asking the user to type the name perfectly. So server says, I could not find the document which you asked for, but choose from what I have. So, if you want to say whether the default directory browsing is enabled or not, what you have to go to, again run, go to INET manager, go to default website, you can see here default website, and open the properties. If you open the properties, it would open a page like this. You have to go this time to home directory. You have to go to home directory, and in that you have to check the directory browsing. So, if you can find out directory browsing is enabled or not. Let's check the next page. Okay. You have to go to home directory to find out the directory browsing is on or not. It is here. So, since directory browsing is not enabled, in case the page is not found, it would not show you the list of the files which are there in the directory. If the directory browsing has been enabled, it would show you all the files in the current directory. So, I hope you got the idea. You have to go to INET manager, default website, right click, go to properties. If you go to property, it would open this page. In that, go to home directory. In the home directory, you have to check whether the directory browsing is enabled or not. What happens here if that case is enabled, directory browsing is enabled, it would show all the files. So, the attacker may be able to show the usernames, may be able to see the usernames and password if the directory browsing is enabled. Even if the file name is difficult to guess, the developer has given a very difficult name to a text file which contains usernames and password, but still, because it gives you the list, attacker can identify this might be the file containing usernames and passwords. So, countermeasure, you have to go to the IIS server, default website, go to properties, go to home directory and disable the directory browsing. Chalo. Now, verify that the directory browsing is disabled. So, I am giving you an example. Suppose you have a website called test site and there is a page called test home. If you try to navigate to this page, and if that page is not there and directory browsing is correctly disabled, message would be displayed that directory browsing is not allowed, or you get other error message saying that the page is not available. Now, next is, it is saying elevation of privileges. Common sources are unpatched web servers, unknown vulnerabilities, non-essential service, and canonicalization attack. Elevation of privileges means a particular user does not have rights to certain action, but because of this, the user gets a promotion and he can do activities which he is originally was not able to do. So, for that, who is responsible? Missing patches. The web servers are always in an environment, they are likely to be attacked. Web servers need to be sufficiently patched. That means all the latest modules that need to be appended to the current web server should be appended. The countermeasures, again, missing patches are: use devices like such as application firewall, network firewalls, intrusion prevention systems, so that the systems can sanitize the network traffic to find out whether this traffic is allowed or not. Attacker is able to find another route to your organization's web servers or cause those protective devices to fail, then web server can be easily picked up. apply the missing pages for IIS, there are automated tools available which can find out whether your IIS has any missing patches or not. The tool is MBSA, Microsoft Baseline Security Analyzer. As we have seen previously, there are two ways to verify that the patches are properly installed. One is a manual verification, and then second is a manual for manual verification. You have to find out all patches installed on a machine, and second is what patch should be appended to save the affected files. If they do not match, then you have to download the patches or use the automatic tools, as I mentioned, MBSA, and another tool is Nessus. Verification with an exploit code. So, the best way to get defense against the attacks is use the same tools and techniques that the attacker is using. So, once again, patch has been installed, but to check whether the patch has been installed properly, the verification should be done through the exploit code against testing the machine on which the patch is installed into an isolated environment. There are certain unknown vulnerabilities also. It includes zero-day vulnerability. Zero-day vulnerabilities are vulnerabilities that are, those are not known publicly. The second is buffer overrun. Buffer overrun says how stack and heap works. So, to work with stack and heap, what happens? So, stack and heap grows like you, if you add a data, then it would be added here and it would be added here. Here we want to talk about buffer overrun. So, how does it work if we have allocated a buffer of saying that you want to just print hello, but now you are saying hello, I am the bad. But actually your buffer size was only 5, so you thought that Ahmedabad would not be taken care of. But now what happens that in buffer overrun, though you have got only 5 spaces for the buffer, your input would expand into another memory area, overriding what has been there in the memory. So, though you get only 5 memory size, your input has penetrated into another memory area, that says it is a buffer overrun. So, this time it is 11 bytes and copy hello world. Now, copy welcome to planet hull. What would happen? Buffer overrun would store 12 characters, then it can store. Buffer overrun can write anything in the next memory area. So, it can create DOS condition. DOS condition is nothing but it is a denial of service attack. What are the countermeasures? Disable the unused services, validate the input, validate the type and length on all data, and there are certain filters available. Those filters, for one example, is URL scan. You have to install URL scan. For that, get urlscan.ini. URL scan has certain parameters: max URL, max query string, max header prefix. Max URL, for example, it defaults to 260 bytes. So, if you type more than 260 bytes, it would generate an error. This says there are 800 times A has been repeated, but since the length defined was only 260 bytes, the 800 length of URL would generate an error. The same way you can set another parameters to find out or to filter the URL. Now next is what are the countermeasures? When you write telnet, it gives you header, customer, custom header, max allowed content length is how many zeros? It sounds like a 3 crore ki 30 lakhs, 3. It sounds like 30 lakhs. So set it to 500. So if you set it to 500, the content length of this 90,000 is not allowed. So same way you can check other URL parameters to verify. Now non-essential services. Sometimes when we start our operating system, there are many services running. Few of them are not actually needed by us. So best defenses reduce the number of available services. Organization needs only static HTML. So don't allow ASP or PHP. ASP or PHP are the dynamic contents generating, dynamic content generation applications. So two types of services are there. One is operating system services, another is web server services. Now one more option, on your web server, check how many services are running with a command sc.exe. Give the server name here, and then this is a keyword which you have to use, query.ex. That would tell you how many services are running. And if you want to find a particular service, use a keyword find str, and here you have to provide the actual service name. To give you an idea, how does it work? First you have to say sc.exe, your server name and query.ex. So it would generate the list of the services with the parameter service name, its a display name, type, state, its exit code, win32 exit code, service exit code, checkpoint, wait hint, and its a PID. So this is an information of one service. So whatever services are running, it would be listed like this. I have just given you the example of two services. Now if you want to find out about the particular service, you have, this is a pipe. Output of this would be given as an input to this. So when sc.exe generates an output, out of that find out WUD FSVC service. So I am leaving you as an exercise, what is this service doing in our OS. But to know more about these services, you can use the find str. If you don't want those services, kindly disable the services. Command is sc.exe, give the server name and stop and service name. For example, sc.exe, my server name is www.ldc.edu, stop the messenger services. So it would stop the messenger services. As I said, when the operating system starts, the certain services are automatically starting. To disable that, you have to type a command sc.exe server name config server name start is equal to disable. For example, sc.exe, this is your domain name, config messenger start is equal to disable. It says when an operating system starts, don't start the messenger service. Always inspect the web server's configuration file. The countermeasures are open the IIS manager, check the web service extension folder and prohibit the extension not required. As I said, if a company wants only static pages, there is no need to have AASP or ASHX, or though you want AASP and not .ashx, you can configure accordingly. So for that you have to once again go to IIS manager, inet mgr, open the properties page, open the home directory tab, and in the configuration page click remove for any application extension that your organization does not require. Canonicalization attack, it says you can distinguish between this, that the dot has been converted to percentage 252. So percentage 252 E double decodes to dot. If security is on non-canonicalization forms of input, data attackers might be able to bypass some security feature. I hope you have got my point. Sometimes what happens that the filter is on cmd.exe. The attacker is not allowed to execute this, but what an attacker has done, instead of dot, he has converted it to percentage 252e. So now your web server filter will not recognize that it is a dot, and it may allow attacker to penetrate into the server. The next term is denial of service attack. It's called DOS attack. DOS says your server is flooded with a request, said now the server is tired and can no more reply. There are service level threats. Now, in a service level threat, we would start with a SOAP. SOAP is nothing but simple object access protocol. It's a communication protocol on the internet. It is used for data transport. SOAP has four fields: envelope, header, body, and fault. Envelope is what? It is a start, and it contains start and end of message. Header contains all the message related information. Body contains actual message, and fault, if there is any error occurred during the processing of a message, it would be there in a fault. So why are we talking about SOAP here? Because we are talking about service level threats on the server. When we have any, suppose calculator service, we want to ask to a server that provide me a calculator. So in between the communicating protocol would be SOAP. So you have to try to take care of the envelope, header, body, and fault. An attacker does not include anything malicious into all the fields. Unauthorized access says if there is service running on any port of the server, it should not allow that service to be taken or that service to be rendered to a person who is not a legitimate user for that service. Network sniffing says if the data is transmitting on a network, anyone can read it out, and that is again a major threat because the internet is an open environment, data transmits over the internet. Tampering is one has checked the data, what is going on, and it has modified the data which is being transmitted. We already saw directory browsing and information disclosure. Information disclosure is the data which has been disclosed while traveling on the network. So these are all service level threats. So we have in general talked about the web threats. It includes client level threats, server level threats, and service level threats. I suggested how to countermeasure against all these attacks, but the best solution is to educate the users. Thank you.